Okay, lovely. So, welcome to Story Hour, Meher. And I'm so glad that you'll be here today, that you're here today talking with me. Very special occasion for me because I've always enjoyed talking to you and, you know, not just corporate, but about life in general. And so, welcome to my show. You're the second guest on this show and I'm just so happy it's you.
Thank you.
Yes. So, right away, what I'm going to do today is really not talk so much about, you know, your journey in the corporate world. I would love to talk to you about a little bit about that, but a lot about life and all that happens to us in this journey. But to begin with, because people know you so much as Meher Padamji, chairperson of Thermax, and, you know, somebody who's been a trailblazer for a long time. You joined Thermax as a very young girl. You finished your chemical engineering and you came back to India and joined as an engineering graduate at Thermax. And almost immediately you had, I think, one of the first lessons in humility and being grounded when you were told that you will have to work your way up the ranks, literally. There is this interesting story that you once told me about one of the first tasks that you had to do as an engineering trainee at Thermax was earn rupees 10 for yourself. That was the task that you were given. I'm sure everybody would love to hear about that.
Sure. First of all, thanks a lot for having me on your show, Sudha. I always enjoy talking to you. I'll tell you, you know, actually, both my parents have always insisted that if, first of all, they've always told my brother and me that you don't have to join the company if you don't want to. But whatever you do, give off your best. And at one time, I was very good at the piano. And so my parents even encouraged and said, if you want to be a pianist, we would encourage you. Yes. But obviously, there's a lot of hard work, and for so many that get into something like the arts, very few do extremely well. But if you join Thermax, then you need to join at the bottom. Yes. And so when I came back after I finished my chemical engineering, did I always think I would join Thermax? Probably not. But you know, having been brought up in a family business, you hear so much about the business at the dining table, on weekends, on holidays. So I think in your subconscious mind, there is something that, oh, probably one day I'll join it, you know?
Yes, yes.
And I'm very proud of what Thermax is all about. And so I decided after I finished that I would like to join the company. And so I joined as a trainee engineer. We were 100 people who joined in that year.
Oh.
And out of that, about 6 of us were women. And it was,
that's okay.
We went through a huge, very strong induction program, which Thermax does extremely well. Mm-hmm. And in one of that, those exercises, we went through was where we were all brought into a room, and Anu at that time was working under Prasad Kumar, who was the head of HR. So both of them had done this exercise with us, and they said, we want all of you to go out and earn rupees 10. I'm talking about 1990.
Yeah.
At that time, there were no ATMs. So we couldn't just go and get rupees 10 from an ATM.
Yeah.
So they said, you have to earn it, but the only caveat is you're not allowed to tell people that you are from Thermax. And they gave us about 3 hours one afternoon. And this was in a place in Yashwantnagar in Pune where there are a lot of bungalows.
Mm.
So each of us had to do this on our own. So I went knocking on various doors saying that, can I please do some work in this house? Jharu, pocha, bartan, whatever you want. And the only caveat is at the end of it, you're going to have to pay me rupees 10.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that the bigger the house, the more suspicious the people, you know, sort of opening their doors and thinking, who's this strange person coming and asking for something as crazy as this. And I had only about 20 minutes left and I couldn't find something to do. And I found this Mali in the garden doing khurpi. So I very sheepishly went up to him and I said, can I please help you? And the only thing is at the end of it, you'll have to pay me 10 rupees. And he said, ajao, ajao. And he gave me a sickle and we both sat there doing khurpi. And at the end of it, he took me into his little hut. He gave me a cup of tea and he handed over this 10 rupees. And each one of us had a different experience. So we all came back and we spoke about our experience. For me, it was pretty transformative in the sense that, when we come from engineering colleges, we tend to have a certain arrogance around us, believing that we know everything. We can't learn from anyone and
everything. Ordinary people, yes.
Yeah, we can only give gyan. and this was a very humbling experience for all of us. And the whole idea being that when you're in an organization, you're going to have to learn to work in teams. You're going to have to learn from anything and anybody. And so I thought it was a wonderful experience.
Was it also the first 10 rupee that you had ever earned? You came from a position of privilege, but still, 10
no.
rupees.
Yeah. I'll tell you, actually, when we were very young, my mom is a social worker by training. Mm-hmm. And when we were very young, this family called the Gopal Rams and us, mm-hmm. the children were very close. And every summer, we used to get together and we used to put up plays.
Okay.
And who were the audience? Our parents and their few friends. And if they wanted to come for the play, they had to pay a little money to us. And then we baked cookies and we served lemonade and they'd have to pay for that as well. And then all that money we would take and we would give it to Mother Teresa's home.
Oh, okay.
So it was just something that sort of appealed to us as kids. And that's how we started.
Fantastic. Thanks for sharing that story, Mehr. I want to then step into the next phase of your journey with Thermax. And almost one of the first things that you did when you joined the company that your grandfather set up and then your father grew to great heights and then Anu took it to even greater levels of success. One of the first things that you did when you joined was face this huge challenge of having to go to the UK and, you were put in charge of turning around the fortunes of a joint venture, which was, going down the tube. What was that city? I think you were just 23 or 24, newly married, and you found yourself in this situation. I want to know, what that was like and what are the lessons learned there? Because I think that was more learning than any management degree would have given you at 24 to be put in charge of something like that.
Yeah, it wasn't a joint venture. It was a small subsidiary company of ours in the UK and wasn't doing very well. And so my parents felt that it would be a good idea for Firoz and me to go and try and turn it around. And we were just five of us. It was a very small company. So we had to, there were no proper roles for everybody. We had to do everything. So one day I was a telephone operator. The next day I was on the shop floor. The third day I was in service trying to fix something. I didn't even remember on a Sunday, we got a call from a customer saying that this de-icing equipment, the one that where you de-ice aircraft
is not
working. So you better come right now and fix it. Yeah. And our actual service engineer wasn't available. So Firoz and I, with Zahan, who was barely a few months old, took him with us and we went to fix this de-icing machine. Okay. So, we had to just do everything because it was such a small little unit. And what is wonderful is that when my parents decided to send us there, they asked Dr. Joshi, who at that time was our director and in charge of R&D, would you go along with the kids and be a mentor to them and help them out for a year? even before he could ask his wife, he said, yes, of course, yes. I'd love to. And so he and another engineer, Chid, came along with us. I mean, you know, Sudha, you say that it was my father and my mother and me. And I mean, we take all the, when things go well, it's all the family. When things don't go well, it's the management. But let me tell you that it is the management. We've got a phenomenal team of people. Genuinely very, very good people. So it's the people that make Thermax.
That makes an organization.
Not a quote unquote, just the family.
Yes, I have always heard this from your mom, from Anu speaks about this, how the team is what makes
Thermax. Absolutely. And so when we went, I think some of the biggest lessons I learned was the difference between profit and cash. Mm. You know, this was a fledgling little company where there was just no money. Mm. And I thought that we saw profits on paper, but when we had to actually pay out vendors, pay out salaries, we found, oh my God, there's no cash. And that's the biggest time that I realized, oh my God, there is a difference between profit and cash. And in fact, today, when I talk to people who join Thermax, that's one of the first questions that I ask them. Mm-hmm. You know the difference between profit and cash. And so that's one of the biggest lessons that I learned. I think another big lesson I learned was in terms of working as a team. Working with my husband for the first time. It wasn't easy. But I think we got into a groove of working together. And the third, I think, was time management. Mm. You know, when I was there, I was working from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. I was at the office. Don't ask me what I was doing. I was there. And I just found that when Zahan was born in the fourth year, the babysitter said, I can only look after your son till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And so I said, oh my God, how am I going to manage? And to my utter surprise, I found that by 3 in the afternoon, I was done and ready to go home because I started to learn how to prioritize.
When you're put in a situation.
And I always compare it to sort of living in this huge house. You tend to just accumulate and accumulate stuff over the years. And it just sprawls everywhere.
Yeah.
Suddenly, if you're asked to move into a flat, you suddenly decide, oh, you prioritize. I don't think this is really important for me. I can chuck it out. I don't need to live with this. I can take this out. And suddenly, you tend to declutter your life. Yes. And I think that's the one thing that I learned over there in terms of how to prioritize my time and how to prioritize my work. So that was a very, very important lesson for me.
How did this prepare you? Like, did this actually prepare you for what was to come, or did anything at all prepare you for what came over the next few years from having a sort of sheltered little life, a world of your own in the UK? You suddenly found yourself back in the country at Thermax, your mother in the chairperson's seat. Tragically losing your father, you know, no chance to say goodbye. Did any of this, you know, did anything prepare you for what came along?
I think death is something that I still find it difficult. One can never be really prepared for it. And that's when I think my mom did a super, super job. In terms of having lost her husband, she actually flew back from the UK after being with me for 6 months to find that my dad had come to receive her at the airport and he was no more. So,
who can prepare you for that?
Who can prepare
nothing,
you for that?
Nothing.
Exactly. Nothing in life can prepare you for that. Similarly, for Kurush's death, nothing can really prepare you for that. But I think work-wise, yes, as I mentioned, this whole thing between profit and cash is a huge lesson. In fact, that is really great today in times of COVID.
Yes.
So that's something that has really helped me. I think one thing I forgot to mention was being a woman in the UK. It's strange, but even in the UK, when I used to pick up the phone and say, I'm the sales person, and they'd say, I'd like to speak to the salesman. And I said, sorry, you got me on the other line. And yeah. They wouldn't expect someone in capital goods being a woman.
Yeah.
You know, so if anything, I think India has been easier to handle as a woman in the capital goods sector than even in the UK. I think just being able to manage on our own as well, in terms of personally, there was a lot of learning just being away and just being Firoz and me, and then coming back and again being Firoz and me in the organization. And again, how do we work together as a team? That was something that I think was difficult to start with, but I think over the years it's only improved. I think coming back from just 5 people to, I don't know, 1,000 people, I don't know how many people there were at that time, very tough. In India, I also find that people, you have to keep following up. Yes. In the UK, once a commitment is made by a vendor or a customer in terms of payment, it just happens.
Yeah.
Over here, you just have to follow up and follow up with everyone, which I think is a total waste of time.
Yes.
So I wish people would just stick to their commitment. So that was a different learning. Then over there, we made a lot of decisions ourselves. After coming back, we had to be democratic about decision making. So that was a little difficult. I think it was a phenomenal experience on the whole, just being away and then coming back.
When you came back after that 4-year stay there, suddenly you were at the top of the organization. Did it change the way people looked at you? You know, a lot of people struggle with that in India, because we seem to have organizations which are very hierarchy prone, and we are, you know, looking up at people who are in those top slots. Did what was that? You know, how did you handle that sudden change of everything? Did it change your equations with the friends who were with you, you know, as engineering trainees? How did you cope with that? And how did Anu is a great egalitarian mindset. Did she help you actually here? Because I know her as a person who doesn't know too many hierarchies, doesn't acknowledge hierarchies at all.
Hmm.
How did you?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, when I went away, I went as a trainee engineer. And then unfortunate circumstances, when I had to come back, I joined the board. And then a year later, Firoz joined the board. And it was difficult because, you know, when you are a trainee and you have people your own age, we're all going through the induction period together. We're all friends. I remember I used to go to our water treatment division at our chemical division at Bhosri on the bike with a friend of mine, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And we used to go to sites just around Pune together. Testing various equipment, water treatment equipment of ours. And when I came back, then I got onto the board. I think for me, I felt exactly the same. I mean, they're still my friends. They're still people I've worked with. But I think for them, they found it a little difficult.
Awkward.
Mm-hmm. They found it awkward. Yeah. And so I think it was a tough time. Because suddenly you feel that distance.
Yes.
Which I really didn't want, and I really didn't think there should be any difference. But I can also understand where they are coming from. But I would say for some people, it didn't matter.
Hmm.
They continued to be friends with me. They continued to come to my home. But for many, it was difficult.
It is self-induced or whatever, that whatever was there, it was in their mind.
I guess so. And I can imagine how it must have been.
a lot of people say that success comes with a price, and one of the prices that you pay is that life becomes quite isolated and very solitary.
Hmm.
Is that something that you will agree with?
Yes and no. I would say, they say YPO in fact started because of that. The Young President Organization, where they said that people who are at the top of an organization, it can be very lonely out there because you've got to take many decisions yourself. You can't discuss it with too many people. And therefore, they started this Young President's Organization where you are actually part of something called a forum.
Yes.
So you talk about your business, you talk about your personal and your family, and it's a safe space for you to talk. So you have very people who are from non-competing businesses who are part of this forum. So we did join YPO, and it has been an extremely helpful and safe place to talk about whatever we want. But at the same time, I feel it also depends on you as a person. So I am the kind of person who will, luckily I've got Feroz. So in some ways, he's my partner in terms of discussion, thoughts, whatever. So I think that's very helpful. I've got Anu, who has gone through a lot of all this. So bouncing ideas. And now it's so lovely that I've got my children. I just find that I'm amazed at the wisdom that children bring to the table. So very often I've asked Zahan or Leah a question, and the kind of answers that they give us, I'm quite blown away. You know, so I
do you take problems to them? Do you take issues to them and say that this is a dilemma I have?
I do, and now more and more. And I just find that they come up with really good advice, really good.
So on that note, I would like to then ask, I think what is a predictable question, but when you joined Thermax, your parents gave you the choice of joining or not joining. Does that also apply to Zahan and Leah? Like, what is your outlook about, them, or what is their outlook about the family business?
So, absolutely, Sudha. I mean, they are totally free to join the business, or if they don't want to, again, they are free to do whatever they want, and I would support them, provided they are serious about it. So, let me just start with Zahan. He's finished his economics and came back to India, very keen to join Thermax. So he joined us in Danstoker, which is one of our subsidiaries in Denmark.
Okay.
He was there for 4 months in marketing, and then went to Southeast Asia and was there in the Philippines as well as Indonesia for a few months. And then decided that, and then we really spoke about it and said, I never took the opportunity to actually go out and work before joining Thermax. So we asked Zahan, does it make sense for you to work for a few years outside? Because all said and done, when you're in the organization, you are Anu's daughter or Feroz's son or whatever it
is. You never outgrew that, or you never...
And so Zahan decided, that makes sense. And so he applied to Bain.
Okay.
And got into Bain Consulting. So he spent a year and a half over there. And then in February this year, he came back to Thermax. And he's just now working in a small subsidiary of ours called Tosil.
Okay.
And he's working under the operations head, learning from him, probably to take over from the operations head in the next few months or a year. And so I'm really happy because he's enjoying it. He's putting in a lot of effort, and it's very different to Bain. In fact, he jokingly says that, in Bain, when he used to travel, he used to stay in 5-star hotels. And now he has to stay in Thermax guest houses, which are nothing like a 5-star hotel. So, and Leah, is studying music technology. So she's going to go into her fourth year at New York University. And I don't think she wants to join Thermax, but at the same time, she wants to be associated with it in some way.
Okay.
And so it was really nice, but about, I think it was 2 years ago in the summer when she came here, one of our executives organized an excellent program for her.
Okay.
Where he actually took her around to the customer sites where we supply our equipment.
Mm-hmm.
So he took her to the Lay's factory. He took her to a chocolate factory, to 3-4 different types of showing the process of how wafers are produced or how chocolates are produced.
And therefore, your company helps.
And therefore, how does Thermax help them to make awesome. These chocolates? So it helps them in heating or cooling or water treatment or wastewater treatment. So it was a very nicely organized program.
Mm-hmm.
And Leah loved it. And so I think it's important also for us in family businesses to make it interesting.
Easier, yes.
For kids, especially when they're young. You know?
She's what, 20?
She's 21.
20.
Just turned 21. That's right. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know what she's doing a course right now from an online course with Columbia University right now for 10 days on entrepreneurship.
Oh, okay.
And so who knows? I mean, I think she's a pretty good entrepreneur. So who knows what will happen?
Yes. That sounds lovely. And I'm sure Anu must be, I know that Anu is completely in love with your two children. I'm sure that she's looking forward to their making that decision. And but I also know that Anu is always like that everybody takes their own decisions and I stand by them, whatever they are.
Yeah.
Mel, I wanted to ask you about a lot of young women in India are, you know, always looking towards women like you, you know, for lessons that they can take from you, for inspiration, for motivation, because I think that we are still in a situation in India where there are not as many women in corporates, especially in heavy engineering and, you know, shop floors and all of that. But just any woman who has a dream in her heart, we need to find inspirational, motivational messages for them. I want to know from you, you've been there for the last 30 years in Thermax. You've seen lots of ups and downs and hard times and, you know, challenging times. I want to talk to you about, you know, crisis and how do you handle crisis. One of the biggest things is that I've heard that a lot of women give up doing anything at all because they are scared of challenges that will come along. They're always second guessing themselves. They are not, you know, I read somewhere that women say no to a lot of things, anticipating trouble.
Hmm.
They're already anticipating failure. And so they say, no, you know, this is okay. I don't want to take the next step because this is okay. This might happen and I don't want to be in that position. I want to talk to you about challenges and crisis and facing failure. How do you deal with that?
So first of all, I don't think I could give up. I don't think that's the answer. And I think Anu taught me that really. Because in the year 2000, we went through a very, very difficult time as an organization. And our share price, which was 420 rupees, had come down to 36 rupees. We made a significant loss for the first time. And as a family, we did come together and said to ourselves, should we just sell? You know, I mean, is this the time to sell out? And Anu is the one who said, you know, I think that is, in a way, failure. You're admitting to failure.
Failure.
So why sell out now? If at all we ever want to sell, sell it when it's at the peak, you know.
Let's not seem like you're walking away.
Yeah, let's give it our best. Let's put in our efforts.
Yeah.
And And then, of course, the rest is history in terms of us bringing in a consultant to help us turn around the company. And it was really tough because, you know, we had never asked people to leave except on the grounds of integrity. So this was the first time that we had to ask many people to leave. Uni will remember, in fact, he led HR at that time. Mm-hmm. And so it was really, really tough times. And I think if I were to say another tough time that we are facing is today. We're facing a crisis, a pandemic today.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, I think the whole world is facing it. And I think for the first time, it's not just the demand side that's been impacted, but it's also the supply side.
Yeah.
And also for the first time, everyone world over has been impacted. Whereas in 2000, we kept telling ourselves that the economy is down and,
there's a recession.
There's a recession. Don't worry, we will come out of it when things go up. But there were many other people who were doing well, even at the time of the recession. That's not the case today. There are very few people who are really doing well, some industries. And so I think during this COVID time, I think the first thing for any leader is to stay calm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because if you are really anxious, I think that flows into other people, yes. That vibe goes to others, and it's not helpful in the organization. And so I think the most important thing that we have felt during this time is the safety of our people. Mm-hmm. I think that's the most important, so that people are well, people are safe, people are honest in terms of not coming to the factory or to the office when either themselves or someone in their family is not well.
Not well. Yeah.
You know, so we're pushing people to really be honest and transparent, and that we will not penalize you if you're honest and transparent.
There's but a lot of fear about that, yes.
Yeah. In fact, the other way, we will penalize you if you're not honest, you know.
Okay.
I think I would say that the company has done phenomenally wonderful stuff. I mean, everyone, in any crisis, I think everyone comes together because you want to see you succeed and come out of a crisis. So the whole organization has come together. We formed a core group of the MD, our joint managing director, our HR head and finance, Firoz and me. Mm-hmm. And we used to speak 3 times a week when it first started. Now it's gone to once in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Just to get an idea of what's happening with regard to people, what's happening with regard to orders, what's happening with regard to cash. This is where cash...
What has been the impact? Are you... everybody, of course, has been hit very badly. But have you had to take sort of tough decisions?
So one decision that we took, Sudha, is we're not going to ask anyone to leave immediately. Yeah. I mean, I think it's so difficult out there. And we don't have social security in our country. So that's one big decision.
That's wonderful news, because that's not what I'm hearing everywhere, you know.
But also, Sudha, different people are in different situations.
Yes.
You know, secondly, but we have taken salary cuts. Mm-hmm. And so right from the top, the highest is 20%. And mm-hmm. then as you go down the line, it comes down as low as 3% and then some zero.
Mm-hmm.
Our union, mm-hmm. our people, our workers came mm-hmm. forward and said mm-hmm. that we are willing to take a salary cut. I mean, that to me was wow, you know.
Yes.
I mean, our people really care.
Yes.
We've also had to do a lot of things with regard to mental health. You know, so we've got counselors on call. We organize things like yoga classes, cooking classes, just to keep spirits up.
Yes.
We've got people at sites. Mm. You know, people who've been stuck there for months together.
My God.
And I wouldn't say stuck, because they're actually working, because some of the sites are running.
But still not
able to get home. How do you keep them in touch with the company? How do you keep them in good spirits? I think keeping people in good spirits at a time like this is the most important thing. Because if they are not in good spirits, they're not going to be able to do anything. And then, of course, this whole focus on cash. You know, so we'd rather say no to orders than take orders, and then 12 months down the road, we have no money.
Nothing. Yes.
So I think a lot of learnings that we've put in place, and I'm very proud of the team. And in the midst of all this, Uni's retiring at the end of August. And we have a new managing director, Ashish, coming in.
Okay.
So Ashish is right now in Delhi. So it's great because they're working together very seamlessly. And I'm amazed that through this, so much that can be done through Zoom and just working from home. We tried doing something like working from home because we thought it would increase the number of women wanting to join Thermax. So we wanted to try that out 2 years ago. And many people said it won't be possible in an engineering manufacturing company. It's just not possible.
Did it work?
Necessity is the mother of invention. You know, I mean, we're forced to do it today.
Yes.
It's not the most productive way of doing it, but it's very good. And it's working much better than we had expected.
So I'll ask you a connected question. So one of the things that we all, I think when I was a business journalist, I joined as a business journalist in 94. And since then, up till now, one of the things that I constantly hear is that there are not enough women on shop floors and in engineering companies and those kind of things. Has it changed? And is, you know, I've heard you talk about this a lot. What is the situation now? And as are you doing something about that at Thermax?
So, Sudha, sadly, it hasn't changed very much in Thermax, although I'd love it to change. We have done a few things which have helped. Number one is that we have increased the number of intake of women from the engineering colleges. So we've said that let's move it to 25%. So one in four people that join us at the engineer trainee level, let's push it to have women, obviously on merit.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. And so we've started with that a few years ago, in fact. We also have a an internship program. You know, when people are at college, in their third year at engineering college, they have to do like a summer project. So in that also, we have pushed ourselves to take more women, because very often those same summer projects then give us a chance to recruit that person. So we've tried.
They're already familiarized with that. Exactly.
So that's the second. Third, I must say, Sharad and his team have done a phenomenal job in terms of getting women on the shop floor. So in Savli, in Baroda, near Baroda, we have I don't remember now how many, but probably about 19 or 20 women, young women, who are working on the shop floor. They are all in their early 20s. And it's made such a difference in terms of productivity. They are more productive than the men on the shop floor. And they love it. It's great to see them.
That's
on the
lovely
shop
to
floor.
Hear. And
so we've repeated the same thing at another manufacturing plant of ours at Sri City. So we've got young women working there too. And I just hope that we can increase it a lot more.
I think this is something other companies can take then, you know.
Many are doing it already. But yeah, I think it's wonderful.
Fantastic. I want to come to a few questions that will, you know, in short sentences, help give tips to women who are listening into this. So I want you to tell me maybe three or four things that, you know, that you do to keep yourself fulfilled and contented, and also tips for women entrepreneurs or women who are aspiring for, you know, to go after their dreams. So what are those behavioral things that your, you know, attitudes and practices, best practices that you have adopted that have helped you in the long run?
Yeah. So, you know, it's a little different for me because I come from the family. But if someone has to work their way up in an organization, professionally. I guess it's a little more difficult, or yes, not more difficult, I would say. But a few things I would definitely say is, one is have confidence in yourself. I remember taking over from Anu in the year 2004. Very diffident, very, very diffident, because I just felt here are two parents who have done so brilliantly well. How the hell am I going to get into their shoes?
Yes.
I was pretty young. I was in my late 30s and just had my second daughter, my second child.
Yeah.
No, it was mid-30s. Yeah.
Yeah.
Late 30s. And so I just felt that, how am I going to do this? And Anu wrote me a very beautiful letter to say that an apple tree cannot give oranges. So, which basically means that, don't try and be somebody that you're not or somebody else. Give off your own strengths. Mm. You have such good strengths, and give off your very best. What can you do beyond that? So so I think that helped a lot. And so I would say, have confidence in yourself. I would also say that, you know, sometimes women tend to, if you don't get a promotion, if you get a bad appraisal feedback. Sometimes women tend to say, oh, it was because I was a woman. This male boss gave me this kind of feedback, or didn't promote me because I'm a woman. But sometimes I would say women also need to reflect and say, is it genuinely because I'm a woman, or because I haven't achieved what I was supposed to? You know, so I think calibrating that, and keeping a distinction between your being a woman and your performance.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that's really very important. And I would say also, probably trying to mentor younger women coming into the organization, to try and see that they feel safe in the organization. They feel this is an organization that I can grow in. We just started Flexi Time. In fact, I think it was in February. February 1st we started.
And then of course everybody got Flexi Time.
Everyone got Flexi after that. This whole thing about working from home now, I hope this will bring in many more women into the workplace, because now there's no workplace. You can really work from anywhere.
Yes.
So it's not just women. We can tomorrow get good engineering talent sitting in Poland or Timbuktu.
Yes.
That's the whole idea of this work from home.
So it has been a sort of blessing also then, because people who could otherwise not come to work, especially women, like you said, because they have small children or whatever.
Absolutely.
Now, I think this could be a blessing in disguise for a lot of those kind of people.
Absolutely. And Sudha, also, I find that with the millennials, whether men or women, many of them morning is not a great time for them. You know, it's the night.
Yes.
Yeah, so they like to sleep in a little late.
The bio clock is all
different. Changed. Exactly. Yeah. And I just feel that we have to move with the times. So today, with technology, with digitization, we should be talking about output.
Yes.
You know, rather than clocking 9 to 5. I mean, yes. Why clock it?
As long as the job gets done.
Exactly. Exactly. And you can measure that output.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. You once told me that one of the things that helps you always stay balanced and peaceful and calm is that you don't sweat the big, you know, small stuff. So I find that, you know, I've always found that something that I use, because I found in my life that I sweat a lot of the small stuff, and then you don't achieve anything. You're just worrying about something that might or might not happen. And then when I look at you, I realize, okay, so this is something that everybody can learn from, that save the energy for things that really matter. So that's a good. I want to come. We have just 12 minutes left. So I just want to come to talk to you about something that has really fascinated me. Your interest in music, and you always have said that your passion for music has helped you become a better leader, a better person. I want to know about that. You know, your journey with music and the leadership lessons that you have learned from music.
See, music has been really my passion right from childhood. Both my parents are very, very fond of music. My mom, more Indian classical, which I didn't really vibe with. But my dad was much more Western classical, which I was totally in tune with. I remember every night my dad would play the Moldau, which was my favorite by Smetana. And I wouldn't sleep till he actually played that record. And so I learned the piano at a very young age. I started at the age of 7. And in fact, in those days, we used to have something called the Pune Music Society, which had, which still functions today, which had many foreign artists coming to India. So instead of putting them up in hotels, they would put them up in people's homes. So my mom would actually, my mom and dad were actual hosts for many of these artists. So then we would go to the concerts on a Sunday evening. And so I got very involved with Western classical music. And then when I went to school in the UK, I remember that I was taking part in a competition. And my father had come to the UK for 4 days during a holiday. And he rented a little space for me to actually practice the piano so that I could play for this competition. And I was playing the Moonlight Sonata. And just before the concert, he just whispered into my ear, "Meher, play to express rather than impress." And I find that those words have really helped me in everything that I do in life. And then, of course, when I was at college, I joined the choir. And then, of course, my piano took a back seat. And I thoroughly enjoyed being in a choir. And then when I came back to India, I also joined Veronica, who was my piano teacher. I joined her choir. And I just find that, first of all, it's a stress buster. It's very meditative for me. So when people talk of meditation, for me, music is meditation. Yeah, it's my form of meditation. I just find that when I go to the choir, we have such wonderful people who are in the choir. People who are teachers to doctor to a housewife to a young person who's at school. You know, I mean, to a 92, we had a 92-year-old in the choir.
Very diverse.
Very, very diverse group. And so I think when you have such a diverse group, when you have people coming from across society, it sort of brings you down. Yeah. You know, it makes you sort of equal.
Yes.
And I love that. So I'm not the chairperson of Thermax in that choir.
I'm the head in that choir,
you know. But you also talked of leadership lessons. I think one of the biggest lessons is listening. Because in a choir or in any form of music that you play together, you have to listen to the other person. And you cannot be one above the rest. You have to blend in. You know, so it is at the workplace. You have to listen to the voice of the customer, to the voice of your employees, to whoever it is, in order for you to be a good leader. So I think the power of listening has been extremely helpful from the choir. And just being, you know, not trying to be, I want my voice to be heard.
So it's a teamwork, actually.
Yeah, I think being almost sort of being able to work as a team. So the whole team spirit, the whole listening is very important.
Fantastic. And are you still very much... So how does the choir happen now? Are you... you must be missing that.
I miss it a lot. Yeah.
I can remember.
We wanted to try and Zoom.
Yeah. I was about to ask you. It won't happen on Zoom.
Very difficult.
Oh. Yeah. I'm sure some smart tech person will work on that. And then you will be back Zooming in the choir. I want to also talk to you about another thing that you're very passionate about. You know, Akanksha, Teach for India, as you know, the social venture partners. So much that you're doing, you know, on the side, which makes so much of an impact on the way people are living. Please share something with us about that.
Sure, I would say a lot of that has sort of come to me through my mom. As I mentioned to you, right from childhood, you know, when we used to put up these plays.
Yes.
And it was Anu who wanted to bring Akanksha to Pune many, many years
ago. I remember that, yes.
20 years ago, probably. And I've always partnered her because I just, you know, it's not even you feeling that you're helping someone else. The kind of joy that you get from it, or the return on investment, so to speak.
Yes. Yes.
Is infinite.
Emotional return on investment.
Absolutely. Absolutely infinite. And I mean, whether it's Teach for India, I'm just amazed that there are so many youngsters. And it gives me a lot of hope. So many youngsters who are passing out of IITs, IIMs, who are in a McKinsey or a BCG or whatever, you know, who want to leave the corporate sector and want to work for social causes in education. And they join the fellowship at Teach for India. And 60% of them, in Pune, it's 80% of those that finish the fellowship after 2 years actually stay on in the social sector. So I think it's just wonderful because they are the ones who really can make the change. Mm. And whether it's through Akanksha, through Teach for India, SVP is another one where I spend some of my time. And I think it's a wonderful, wonderful group of people. It's first of all, it's SVP is in 7 cities in India. And if you want to give of your time, mm-hmm. of your skill set, and a little bit of money, this is an excellent platform to be on. And so social venture
partners. What are the areas that SVP works in now?
So SVP in India has decided to work on livelihoods.
Okay.
Something that is just so important to do. And so we are trying to work. So we work with NGOs and we all come together as equal partners.
Okay.
And then we put in this amount. And so that's like a corpus. And then we decide together as to which are the NGOs we want to support. And those are the NGOs that are helping people to get to either become self-entrepreneurs or to get jobs. Okay. So we've worked with probably about 7 different NGOs across Pune about over the last 5-7 years. And it's wonderful because you again come in as a partner. You have one voice, one vote. Yes. Everyone is equal. There's nobody who's more equal than another. And we have a lot of fun in terms of deciding who to partner with. We go and visit those NGOs. We visit the beneficiaries. We call them to the meetings. They share with us in terms of what changes have they gone through. So it's just a lot of fun.
I want to ask you, would you like to share with me one example, one standout example that, you know, you must have come across, which SVP or one of your many philanthropic or, you know, those kind of efforts have kind of touched. Somebody's life changed because somebody cared enough to give them a helping hand. It would be very, yeah. very inspiring to hear that.
So I think there are many such youngsters, but one that really, really I'm very fond of is a girl called Priyanka.
Okay.
She was a Teach for India student. In fact, she wasn't a Teach for India student. She was in another classroom.
Okay.
You know, Teach for India does one grade. So say grade A, but they don't do grade B.
Yes.
So she was in the other classroom. And Teach for India had decided to do this performance called Maya.
Mm. Yes, of course, I remember Maya. Yes, yes, of
and
course.
So the rehearsals were going on. Mm. And this young girl, Priyanka, said, can I be part of the rehearsals? So she took part and she was outstanding. So Teacher India roped her in.
Okay.
She became part of the Maya, entire Maya event.
Yeah.
And then she applied to UWC to be Teach for India and Akanksha, have children applying to United World College.
Yes.
And today there are about 14 or 15 children that have been sent to UWC world over.
That's fantastic.
And then they are sent to college. So this girl actually got into UWC Italy.
Wow.
And so she spent 2 years over there. And the kind of letters that this girl writes, and she keeps in touch with so many different people who have been of help to her. And just her thought process, what she's going through, what are some of the challenges being an Indian in Italy, you know. And now she's at Franklin Marshall in the US in her fourth year.
Wow.
And what is phenomenal about this young girl, she comes from a home that has a single mother because her father was in jail or is in jail today for murdering someone.
Okay.
So this young woman is fabulous. And I'm sure she's going to be somebody whom many of us will look up to in years to come. I mean, I look up to her today.
That is such a story of hope, and you know, it's so inspirational. And to know that all of you have in some way contributed to giving that woman a chance, it's all about that, isn't it? That we all come to the world with some gift, but many of us, you know, we don't get the chance to use that gift or that talent because we don't have the same opportunities. So I think this is a good message to give, that we can all help make a change in somebody else's life. And I know you and Anu are constantly on that job. And Anu, I remember Anu once telling me that the joy of giving is much more than the joy of taking. And all the best to you, you know, in this journey, Meher. And it has been wonderful talking to you. I wish I could take questions, but we are out of time now. But thank you very, very much for joining me here today. I had a fantastic time talking to you, and I hope you did too.
I did. Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.